Hello and welcome to this edition of the Clean Energy Pod, powered by SSE, your guide to the people and technologies delivering the clean energy revolution. On this episode, we discuss the latest UK budget, the first in 14 years for a Labour government, and a government that has promised to deliver clean power by 2030. We'll talk to a couple of experts from here inside SSE about what the budget means for the clean energy transition and that mission of delivering a net zero energy system by the end of this decade.
Well, we've just heard from the Chancellor, Rachel Reeves. She sat down in the House of Commons just a few minutes ago. So the budget is very fresh. And the caveat with every budget ever is what we hear from the Chancellor on the day sometimes gets unravelled in the days afterwards when these reams and reams of information are published and everybody pours over the details. But let's try and get an initial reaction to what was actually in the budget. We know going into it that there was a lot of attention because Labour's first budget in 14 years in terms of tax, in terms of spending, in terms of how you can generate growth in the economy, and energy is going to be a big catalyst for that growth. So let's discuss what's in the budget and what it means with Duncan Williamson, who is Director of Corporate Finance here at SSE, and Declan Burke, who's been on the pod beforehand, who's Director of Strategy here at SSE. Duncan, you used to be in the city as well before you came in to join SSE, and Declan used to be a senior civil servant. So actually, brilliant backgrounds to discuss the budget as well. So you've heard Rachel Reeves talking this afternoon. Big moment for her, of course, and a big budget this has been portrayed as. What are your top headlines from what you've heard, Duncan?
Well, thank you for having me here today. It is obviously a big day for the UK, big day for Labour. As you say, Labour's first budget in power and first one for 14 years. So I guess there's a few observations I'd make. One, this is heavily trailed. There wasn't an awful lot of new information in the budget today. Most of what came out today, we already knew, certainly the policies, if not the numbers. I think the big headline was on the tax increases, the £40 billion of which business will bear most of that cost. I think there was a little bit of nervousness in the market beforehand. If you track the markets, you would have seen that government costs have been increasing since the summer. I think though, when we looked at the screens today during the course of the budget, there was some confidence and some comfort taken from some of the messages, and it was a pretty disciplined budget in terms of the fiscal policies. And then the final point I'd make is from an energy perspective, that the big positive today was on that big headline theme of invest, invest, invest. And the number that was used was a commitment to £100 billion over the next 5 years. So a real positive there.
And we know that this government has made, you know, clean energy by 2030 one of its core missions. So we presume that a lot of the growth that the Chancellor is depending on will come from investment in areas like clean energy. We could talk an awful lot about tax and spending and public service and all that sort of stuff. There's loads of other places people can get that information. Let's focus on this podcast, if we can, on those three words, invest, invest, invest. And Declan, any specific energy-related investments in the Chancellor's speech?
I think the key ones probably had been trailed, as Duncan said, in advance. So I think they've made quite a big carbon capture announcement a couple of weeks ago, the Prime Minister and the Chancellor. So that was about £20 billion. So that was quite a big, significant one. So you saw reference to carbon capture and hydrogen in the budget today. So those came out. I think there was also reference to the National Wealth Fund. So I think some of the kind of the tools they set out in their manifesto around investing in the clean energy mission. So National Wealth Fund, and also leveraging that capital. I think it was like £60 or £70 billion they wanted to kind of leverage in on the back of that funding. So I'm sure one of the things they'll want to get across is willingness to use the government balance sheet to invest. And you know, Duncan's talked about the fiscal rules, but also creating the investment climate for companies like us to invest as well. And you saw the investment summit and a bunch of stuff leading up. So you saw some energy content, but I think it was probably that overarching theme of creating the right investment climate, using the government balance sheet in the right way to catalyze things. And that feels like it should be a kind of a positive backdrop, I'd have thought, for the 2030 mission.
And Duncan, let's talk about that investment background then, because SSE alone's got like a £20 billion investment program, but we're just one company. There's lots of other companies investing as well. We're talking about tens and tens and tens of billions of pounds being invested in over the next 5 years alone, further less beyond that at a sector level. When companies are looking to invest and grow, what is it you're thinking about? And what role do you think government has to play in giving you confidence in the policies to allow you to say, you know what, we're going to deploy capital into some of these technologies?
Yeah, we obviously have a big investment plan ourselves, £20 billion over the five-year period to 2027. There's different elements to that investment plan. There's the renewable part, there's the network, and there's the flexible generation part. But when we look at some of the more nascent technologies, and I think the government's been quite focused on some nascent technologies there, what we're looking for and what other investors are looking for is certainty. And it's really hard when it's a nascent technology and you don't have experience in it for people to have certainty. The lack of certainty pushes up risk, it pushes up costs, it pushes up the need for higher returns and higher prices. I think what is helpful is for government to take a lead. And that's what they've tried to do today is say, we will be there with you, we will be investing alongside you. And government putting its money where its mouth is in terms of funding some of these new initiatives is really helpful. I think we saw this 10 years ago in offshore wind, for example. We're seeing it again now in new technologies.
Hello, let me interrupt you for just 1 second. It's really important, if you can, to like, comment or subscribe, because it helps more people get access to the information in this podcast, which we hope you're finding valuable.
And from a city perspective, given your experience, because there aren't that many details in a budget. So, and we've seen today, you know, some positive reaction from the city. It's all piled different things you can look at, share prices and everything else. But it seems like the city likes it, but there's not a great deal of detail. So can you explain to us, put your city hat on, and why are they feeling a bit warm and fussy about this?
Okay, well, back to my old job. I'd say there was uncertainty coming into today. If you look back at government borrowing costs since the summer, government borrowing costs have gone up by roughly 50 basis points, 0.5%. That is the market saying, we're pricing in this uncertainty and we need a return on this higher risk. So in a way, the city, the market was fearful of some of these changes. There's a lot more borrowing on the government balance sheet now than there was in the past. I think what we saw today was some stability. The discipline around the new investment rule, the new stability rule, those are positives. And the market was positive today. The stock market was up and government borrowing costs were flat throughout the budget today. So some comfort taken after a period of relative uncertainty.
Now, Declan, the way that governments deal with budgets is different by government. But traditionally, my understanding is that the Treasury like to hold the cards close to their chest. So you used to be a senior civil servant. So do you guys, just take us into that room for a while, let's go back to your previous career, are you guys watching the Chancellor and going, oh, how the hell are we going to make that work? Or do you get advance notice and are the plans already well in place? How does this work?
I guess linking to Duncan's point, these are market-sensitive documents. So the core of the budget is definitely held pretty tightly. But there'd be a huge amount of work around all the different departments around what's going into the budget, what are the kind of key announcements. So there'd be a fair bit of foresight on that. And as well as the budget, there's the spending review for the different departments. So you saw some of that come out today. I think spring, they're going to set a longer-term budget for each of the departments. And they were talking, you'd have heard today, about things like, you know, efficiency targets for different government departments. But equally, I think there has been a budget increase for departmental spending coming through. So there'd be a huge amount of debates around different departments putting their projects forward, their budgets. So it's a major moment in the life of Whitehall, for sure. Definitely, yeah, it's a big, big event.
And the point that Duncan made about government providing stability. So it seems the initial reaction, again, that caveat has to be given. The initial reaction seems to be that there's relatively positive from the city. But from an industry perspective, again, there wasn't much detail in here, especially when it relates to energy. But do you think that it gives an industry that is about to invest an awful lot of money a bit more comfort today than they had yesterday, perhaps?
I think probably it does. I was in the government side during the trust quarantine budget, which was, you know, a pretty exciting budget to be in Whitehall for. To invest, it is important, I guess, you know, borrowing costs, a stable investment climate, the UK being a good place to put capital, that's got all sorts of benefits to people like us looking to invest money and our shareholders. So you also saw, I think, you know, there was a pretty core narrative, I guess, coming through today, you know, fix the finances, invest in public services, and that overarching kind of growth agenda. And you can see we're trying to balance those three. So create more headroom to borrow, but pretty clear around the visibility of when you're going to balance the books and the role of the OBR. So I think putting those component pieces, I guess the other thing, she did reference things like, you know, non-fiscal measures, like, you know, planning, making planning more streamlined so people can get projects away. the role the kind of clean power mission and Chris Stark and his new team have. So delivering on some of that, I think, in terms of the investment climate, there's some various things we might touch on in a moment, like some REMA, some of those sort of policy developments, making rapid progress on those, which aren't necessarily fiscal spend money, but they will be pretty important, I think, for us to invest as rapidly as we want to.
Let's see, and this probably won't happen, let's say it all works magnificently, as if it's set out in the speech, you know, so Nirvana is delivered and we get HS2 and we get all this investment, clean energy, we get all this other stuff. Billions and billions and billions invested in infrastructure. You mentioned jobs. Have we got the people and can we get people in with the right training and everything else to deliver what seems an almost generational change in investment and infrastructure development?
Yeah, a huge challenge, I guess, isn't it? I did see they talked about setting up a new skills agency as well. I think there was a kind of a mention, I think, on the skills point. And then I think education did look like it was one of the departments that was going to benefit from extra funding.
Yeah,
I think we said it was about 140 graduates. So there is last year, so there is a real need. But it feels like it's kind of a good problem to have. You know, you've got growing industries, but then as long as you kind of plan to bring people in at the right pace, which is really important. But
No, I agree. It's one of the challenges that we face is getting the right people into the industry. I think we're somewhat helped by the transition itself, and there's a lot of people looking to move from higher carbon industries into the renewable industry. So Declan and I are actually up in Shetland in this summer, seeing the Viking onshore wind farm up there. And one of the things I took away from that was just how many people on that project were from the oil and gas industry. So yeah, it's a challenge, but it's not insurmountable.
And what you really want is those people to have just a visible pipeline of work. They can go from one project to the next project, you know, so it's, yeah, that's a good.
On the budget, do you think, and I know again, caveats and details, do you think we are, that the, even though there's not much detail, that the accelerator on the clean energy transition has been depressed a little bit further today, or do you think we're fairly neutral? Are you a bit more excited about things today than you were yesterday? I'm just trying to get a sense of that.
Well, I'd say the direction of travel is positive, and there was a lot of rhetoric there, which is helpful. But was there much tangible announcement today? Was there much tangible evidence in the announcement today? No, there wasn't. I think a lot of it had been front run. So I think the challenges remain. There's an awful lot to do to be net zero by 2030.
Yeah, that feels right, doesn't it? You know, it was an important moment for the government to come through. Like to your point, we'll see over the next couple of days just how it lands. You know, there's always pasty tax or whatever we've seen in previous years, so we'll see how it lands. But it probably was sort of, you know, steady as she goes. There wasn't a huge amount on the energy side, but that broad investability, climate, you know, the market response, that looks like it's been pretty positive.
Yeah.
But the work of the department, and importantly, probably not looking to make big cuts to the department funding. That was probably, you know, it's an indirect thing, but that's probably pretty important.
And from a policy perspective, you mentioned earlier on, Declan, something called REMA, which is a kind of review of electricity markets in the UK. If anybody's following Energy Twitter or Energy LinkedIn or anything, they will know this is a kind of topic that keeps on being brought up. It's essentially, the big question is about zonal pricing, whether we should have a single electricity system, or should we break that up into a whole pile of different zones. There are some who believe that would be a good idea. There are others, principally on the developer side, I don't think that that's a brilliant idea. SSE's view has been clear. It's not something that the company supports. But that kind of policy debate, isn't that a healthy thing? Or actually, does it have an impact on investment decisions and the pace of reform that we need?
Yeah, I think when I used to work on the government side and we were trying to bring capital in, we always recognized if you create uncertainty, you are going to pay more for that capital, and ultimately that does hit the consumer. So what you're really trying to find is, like, what's the most efficient thing that delivers the cheapest energy for consumers? And I guess our view, as you say, Raymond, is especially with this move to more planning. So, you know, you mentioned the grid, for example. We're going to build the grid in the right place, so when we put the wind generation there, we can bring it to where it's needed. If you have a planned approach like that, and then you've got all the kind of measures behind it, you know, investable business models and so forth, our view is that's the best way for the consumer, especially if you want to deliver in 2030. And I suppose, you know, this REMA policy has been going for a while now. So, you know, there's been a very kind of fulsome debate. So hopefully it's one of the areas where, you know, the government come out, give some confidence to industry. If we're making these big long-term investment decisions for decades, you don't want that kind of uncertainty probably in the eyes of investors in the background. So hopefully that's one they'll make progress on pretty quickly. And I think we published some analysis supporting our view pretty recently as well, Raymond, to inform the debate.
Hello, let me interrupt you for just 1 second. It's really important, if you can, to like, comment or subscribe, because it helps more people get access to the information in this podcast, which we hope you're finding valuable.
And there are other views than that. Just, you know, Google it and you'll find lots of other people thinking about that stuff as well. And Duncan, with the budget now over it, and as you say, there's this kind of competition for capital, especially when it comes to clean energy, not only in Europe, but internationally now. Given what the government's talking about in terms of investor climate, investor-friendly climate, given the record we have in terms of developing clean energy technologies, do you think that the UK is now a genuine world leader when it comes to clean energy, is one of the most attractive places to invest?
I do. I think the UK is one of the world leaders in terms of clean energy, if not the world leader. I think if you look back at the track record, the UK's regime, the contract for difference regime to encourage offshore wind, was a regime that was replicated by other countries. And the UK has been at the forefront of the development of some of these renewable technologies. And I think that will continue to be the case. The budget today talking about invest, and setting aside £100 billion over the course of 5 years for capital investment is another positive. It remains to be seen how much of that comes to the way of infrastructure and how much of that goes into renewables and networks. But it's all positive, certainly.
And Declan, you lived through some of those changes. So do you think actually, you know, the success in offshore wind, for instance, that's given government the confidence to take some big bets, because some of the stuff will be big bets. I mean, some of the announcements today were about hydrogen, still fairly nascent technologies, lots of other nascent technologies. If you want to lead, you probably have to take some big bets now that will pay off in 5, 10, 15 years.
Yeah, exactly right, Raymond. You know, when offshore wind was done first, I remember I was in the department, it was like, oh, this is very expensive compared to onshore wind. Why are we going offshore? And I think it's the same, like to invest in those frontier technologies. And if you don't do it, then some other country will capture the jobs, the supply chain. So you're into your carbon capture, hydrogen, but also things like floating wind. So there's a range of technologies the UK could be naturally really good at. And maybe government can co-invest. But also, you know, we talk about things like business models. Hydrogen is a good example of, you need to look across the whole system. So who's going to be buying the hydrogen and creating the demand for the hydrogen? There'll be lots of people working on that in the department. So government's got a really important role to play to join up that whole picture. So get projects up and running, but then make sure there's a demand for that product as well. And some of your carbon capture hydrogen, they're even more complex than electricity because you're trying to involve industry. But if you get it right, you know, places like Teesside, Humber, you could create a low carbon cluster, which is, you know, resilient and quite attractive for people to locate industries in a low carbon world.
Gentlemen, thank you very much indeed. That's fascinating stuff. Budget day is always an exciting day, but as I say, you've got to, you know, go and read the documents sometimes and find out the exact details. Next big fiscal event, as they call it, I think, is in the spring when there's going to be a spending review. Again, we're back again to pore over that and find out what that means for the energy industry. But for now, thank you very much indeed.
Great. Thanks, Robin.
Thanks very much for joining us. That's all we have time for on this episode. But if you found anything in it valuable, please like, comment or subscribe. Or even better, share with one of your colleagues or friends. See you soon.